with the climate change question exacerbating a lot of issues that are already on the table in terms of our infrastructure becoming obsolete or taking 50 or 75 years to turn around in some cases, we have some big decisions to make, and those decisions may be expensive. And those decisions require a lot of hard thinking by as many different perspectives as possible so that we can come to decisions that we're going to be happy we made now rather than later.
So that's what I would tell an engineer, is to sort of think for themselves about climate, and try to find the points of connection, and also know that if they want to work on climate change, their education is going to be very relevant, because the engineering infrastructure is going to need to be adapted for climate change. And the more that they know about that, what goes into that engineering, the better off they'll be.
And so I see, non-engineers as being critical to this problem, because non-engineers create the environment in which engineers work. And so, we determine what their budgets are. We determine what the problems are that they have to solve. We determine when a solution is good enough to proceed and when it's not. And so the ways in which, we in democracy frame the problems for engineers to solve is incredibly important.
All citizens, including engineers, need to be driving national priorities. We need to do everything that we can as citizens to make clear to our leaders that we need action on climate change, that we need to be taking that action, whether that's locally, which has been a large focus at this conference. I really learned a lot at this meeting about how much municipalities are doing to deal with very local response to climate change. And whether that's your local government, your state government, your federal government, or even thinking about international agreements, we need to be active and demanding that our leaders think about policy changes for climate. And engineers will respond to what the national priorities are. That is traditionally how engineers have worked. So the technology will follow if we can set the national priorities.
The National Academy of Engineering has created these grand challenges, and it's put them out there as if they're engineering problems. They're not engineering problems. They're partly engineering problems. But they're really problems about how do we build the kinds of societies that we want to inhabit in the 21st century. And building societies, this is bad. Social engineering, socialism, communism, right? We get really nervous when we start to talk about not building bridges, but building societies. But that's what we do all the time. We do it as engineers, we do it as social workers, we do it as government officials, we do it as citizens and just as consumers, or even as just people. Everything that we do helps to shape the way that we're able to live as individuals and as communities going forward.
Except in a very trivial sense, there's really no such thing as a purely technical problem. That means to really understand and contribute to this interdisciplinary discussion we've been talking about. Engineers need to appreciate this notion that technology is part of a socio-technical system that involves dealing with more than basic engineering skills. And so they need to know something about ethics. They need to know something about communication. And they need to know something about policy and social science.
Because right now there isn't anybody who can tell you what the job of an engineer is in terms of finding solutions to climate change. Because the one thing that we know it isn't is just building some new bridges or some new seawalls or whatever, right? Or a new information system. It's not just that. And indeed, we won't know, we can't know whether building a seawall is the right thing to do or not unless, one, we understand how that seawall is connected into a whole bunch of systems. I mean, that's the lesson from Broward County at this meeting. Where you know, the fact that there are a whole bunch of tunnels that have been used to drain the land in the county so that we can build on it, that take water out into the ocean, the fact that those tunnels exist mean that seawalls are useless because all the water does is come back up the tunnels underneath and back into the city, right? So you can't know that building a seawall is the right thing to do vis-a-vis sea level rise unless you know the complex set of systems that are in place. You can't know if it's the right thing unless you know what the short and long-term priorities and values of the community are. How is it that the community wants to live in the future? And you can't know those values until they know what the options are.
Well, one of the primary roles of local government is to build infrastructure and to maintain it, to build roads, to build buildings, to make sure that the underground infrastructure like water and wastewater is working. Many local governments operate their own utilities. And those are fundamental services that the citizens expect. To turn on the faucet and the water comes out and you can drink it, or flip the switch and the lights come on, or you can turn the lights off. And local governments own that. But they have been following standards that have been developed by and large by the engineering community that in some cases are 50 to 75 years old. And those standards may have been appropriate in less dense situations, in cooler weather, but may not meet today's tests when you have change in climate or a weather event that is unexpected. And public officials need to begin to get into this dialogue and understand their fundamental responsibility to citizens is to make sure that those services and those roads and sidewalks and such are safe for the public.
I mean, one of my areas of interest and expertise is on policy, and it did strike me a number of times during this conference of the important role of policy in terms of bounding the problems that engineers solve. And creating the kind of incentives for people and engineers to behave in particular ways.
And I think that's one of the things that I hope will come from this conference is an understanding that the engineering community and the scientific community has a great opportunity to really impact the future of this issue by working with local government. You know, we're where the rubber meets the road in America, and we're where these problems have to be grappled with and have to be dealt with.
But, you know, engineers are taught very narrowly in their discipline, and we have this cult of expertise in our society. And so it's a hard step for engineers to do this. On the other hand, they don't necessarily trust other people to do it. So engineering ethics, for example. If a philosopher is teaching the course, then many of the engineering faculty don't respect that because they don't think the philosopher knows anything about engineering. So how can they teach engineering ethics?
Well, I mean, I think a big part of this is engineering education, right? We heard from a few folks who are involved in sort of making policy around engineering education that it's really important to try to have these kinds of questions and sort of the social impacts, you know, embedded into the work that all of us do to learn to become what we are. So if we can think about engineers being at the table and scientists being at the table with policymakers, with community members, with urban planners, then when these difficult conversations, you know, arise, it's easier for us all to be able to have a voice that's, you know, listened to and included in these difficult conversations. And so I think this conference is very unique and interesting because it's kind of has this very interdisciplinary nature. The idea that you're bringing together a bunch of people who have different roles to play in getting communities engaged around thinking and planning and acting for climate change resilience.
Well, it is very interdisciplinary, and I think that is one of the most important things that's happening here, is lots of smart people in government get together and talk, and lots of smart engineers get together and talk. But to bring all these smart people who represent different interests together means we will get a different outcome. We'll get to a place that we wouldn't have gotten if we were just talking to ourselves in these small groups. And that's what I've heard from the folks that are here already, is the opportunity to be with folks who are doing something different, but the intersect is something we all care about, is really sort of a first in a lifetime opportunity. And I think they will go home and want to do it again in their own communities, which is exactly what you would hope they would do. They can have the conversation with international and national leaders, but they can go home and have the same conversation, having seen it happen here.